This is intermolecular forces video part two. It is continued from intermolecular forces video part one, which you can find on YouTube. During this video, we will cover intermolecular forces 4 through 6. All of the 6 types of intermolecular bonding don't require explanation, but one that does is an ion-induced dipole. So let's take dioxygen. Now this is a pretty elaborate picture I have here, but this is dioxygen. And what I'm showing is the sigma bonds where they have the shared electrons bound. So the other electrons are in the pi orbitals. So they're a little more delocalized. But basically there's other electrons too that aren't involved in the bond, the non-bonding electrons, the lone pairs on oxygen. And they're out here, and basically if you center the electrons between the two protons, you basically have a neutral molecule. So as far as the Coulomb's law electrostatic force field around this, it's kind of neutral. But if you bring a nickel ion, a 2+ ion, into the presence of this dioxygen, you can imagine as it starts to get closer, that positive is going to have an attraction on these electrons. And since they're delocalized anywhere here in space, they might shift over, attract to the nickel. Well, as these start to shift, it's going to start to generate these partial negative charges. When you see the epsilon symbol, that is a partial negative charge as opposed to this full-on, I've lost electrons, strong ionic charge. And there's also where the electrons have shifted away, there's going to be a positive end to this dioxygen molecule. I had a neutral molecule in the presence of the ion induced a dipole onto the neutral molecule. And these are much weaker than any kind of dipole-dipole bonds or hydrogen bonds. Now, it isn't much of a stretch to imagine then what the same sort of scenario could happen if you had a dipole that came nearby the dioxygen molecule, like sulfur oxygen, which is actually polar. So as this sulfur dioxide starts to move close, you can imagine the same sort of thing happens where the electrons shift over. It induces a dipole on the dioxygen, make this end negative and this end positive. Also, sulfur dioxide could come in from the other way. It could shift over. It could induce a dipole, but the electrons would be pushed away, put a positive end on this end of the oxygen, and a negative dipole on the end of the dioxygen away from the sulfur dioxide. The last force is what we call dispersion or London forces. How does it happen that you have two neutral molecules with no electrostatic force field around them, and then all of a sudden they bond together? At any time in these neutral molecules, these electrons are anywhere in this delocalized pi orbital. And although they are in between the bonds and the sigma bond, or between the two proton centers in the sigma bond, or they are could at any time be kind of shifted over to this one oxygen or shifted over to this other oxygen. You can imagine at any time if the electrons shift to one side, it could become negative. And as they shift away, that same side would become positive. So let's just take a real slow look at this. As if the electrons all shifted over to one side, that would create a positive where it's a dioxygen molecule where the electrons have moved away from it, negative pole on the other end where the electrons have shifted over. And at that point, that particular dipole on this dioxygen could then shift the other oxygen, and it would create opposite poles, and there would be an attractive force. So this is a very weak, on the order of, you know, almost an order of magnitude below even dipole-dipole interaction. And that explains how two things that are covalent can bond to each other, even though they don't seem to have any kind of electrostatic permanent poles on them. So this could even translate down to molecules themselves. So if you took a helium molecule and it was sitting by itself, alone by itself, you know, the electrons could be distributed anywhere in there. But at any moment, they're probably most likely to be distributed in such a way that they don't create poles around the atom. But if they came near another helium and they started to move, and at any time the electrons were on one side or the other, it would influence the other helium that's near to it, so you would have some attraction. And I think the important part, if you're thinking about this, is gosh, how strong is this? Well, look at the boiling point. That's 4K. That's 4 degrees above absolute zero. So not very strong at all. You have to freeze this almost to the point that there's no molecular motion before these molecules can actually slow down and get close enough that so that this attraction can set up. Now, if you get something that's a little larger, now I've got neon, so there now there's more electrons involved. There's more probability for these temporary dipoles showing up. The boiling point goes up a little, well over 200 degrees below zero Celsius. Okay, it's freezing, but still at that temperature, which is warmer than what helium is, the neons can get close enough to each other and they can actually start to connect. There's a term for this as you're getting larger and larger and you have more, statistically more electrons that can create these temporary dipoles, and that's called polarizability. Bigger atoms are more polarizable than smaller atoms. So you can imagine that as you, if you went down the periodic table in the noble gas family, as you went down to argon, etc., as the atom got bigger, the boiling point would increase. So I want to make an important point about intermolecular forces. It really has to do with points of attraction, not just the strength of the attraction. So now we have a ranking. We kind of know that, you know, hydrogen bonds are the strongest and these London ion dipoles are very strong, but these London forces are very weak, and so there's a ranking. But there's another point, is just about how many points of attraction there are. And the best way to explain this is just a little demonstration I like to show you. So what I want to do is I want to show you what the difference is between small molecules with few points of attraction and then a larger chemical chains where you can get multiple points of attraction, and show you why that you can actually change the intermolecular force. So what I'd like to do is just kind of do a very simple demonstration where I'm comparing two molecules as if I had, say, a simple hydrocarbon chain like methane, and we're looking at how methane binds to methane. Okay, so it's a single intermolecular force or intermolecular bond. At some point, the electrons have shifted over, made these temporary dipoles. This is temporarily negative, while this is temporarily positive. So there's a quick attraction, but that's kind of very weak. So to do the analogy, I'm going to get this tape and I'm going to basically just show you, okay, one small intermolecular force. And in this demonstration, you can imagine that the purple is really like intramolecular forces, the bonding within the molecule holding carbon to hydrogen. And then the tape is like an intermolecular force, like what determines its physical state. So now let's just check how strong this bond is. And you can actually break the bond. Okay, we broke the intermolecular bond. So that was easy enough. So now for comparison, but let's look at something where you increase the length of the chain. So let's just say we have a much larger chain. We'll just see how much of a chain we can make here. But for my example, we're going to go through one carbon methane, ethane, propane, butane, pentane, we'll make hexane. So now there's, before there was one point of attraction, but now there's 6 points of attraction. So we're going to put together hexane molecule here. Maybe we'll make it bigger in my demonstration. So remember, we're still using the same tape, so it still has, in theory, the same strength. We're just giving it more points of attraction. So there's, we're at heptane, we're making octane. We'll just put more points of attraction in here. Okay, so now let's see how this affects the strength of the bond. All right, here we go. That's pretty strong. Okay, now I've actually literally broken the intramolecular bond because there's enough points of attraction that I've increased the strength. So I didn't increase the strength bond by bond, I just gave it more points of attraction. There we go. Just a few important points about IMF points, as I just pointed out in the demonstration. The more points of attraction, even though it may be the same strength of bond, so I have two methane molecules with only one point of attraction, but it's still that weak London force compared to, this is butane like you'd find in your butane lighter. It has 4 points of attraction. And as you know, your butane in your butane lighter is actually liquid at under a little bit of pressure, and then at room temperature it'll turn to gas. So look at the boiling point of methane. It's well below zero. It's 112 K. Now you get more points of attraction. Look at the boiling point, starts to rise. Then you go up to gasoline, which is octane. This is N-octane. It has 8 points of attraction, and look at the boiling point rise. Now we have a weak point of attraction. We're looking at two methanol molecules. We have that weak point of attraction, the inner London force, but we also throw in this hydrogen bond, and look how it changes the boiling point. So it puts it right in between butane and octane. So I use this as an example to remind you that just because the very strong hydrogen bond is present, doesn't necessarily mean that you can totally have higher boiling points than the weaker London forces, because sometimes the London forces have lots of attraction. So you can take something like octane and you just keep going if you go up to things like chapstick and Vaseline, these sorts of materials, or even road tar. These are long hydrocarbon chains that, as we know, at room temperature are actually solid. Okay, the last point about IMF points is, another thing you can do to change the points of attraction is you can change by, or points of contact, and that is by changing the shape of the molecules. So my comparison here is if I take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, basically we have 6 carbons. This is dimethyl butane, but it has 6 carbons. This is basically an isomer to this. This is 6 carbons, N-hexane in a straight line, okay? Now, because of the way this is branched, I can't get 6 points of attraction in here. I can only get, just as I have it drawn here in two dimensions, I can only get 4 points of attraction. But if I go over here, I can actually get 6 points of attraction. And 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And look at the original boiling point. And look what, when I can get more points of attraction, look how the boiling point increases. Now another thing that could happen, this is a very similar molecule, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is benzene, okay? It's a hexane ring and a cyclic with a couple double bonds in there. Now what a benzene ring does is geometrically, it lays flat, so it's very possible to stack these rings directly on top of each other, get 6 points of attraction, but because of the shape, they can really lie close, get very close to each other, and you end up with the even higher boiling point still. So what's my take home here? If you have molecules that have a lot of branching, it usually lowers the IMF, the intermolecular force, i.e. will lower the boiling point and freezing point. Quite often though, rings can organize things for a little tighter bonding. In review, today we're focused on intermolecular forces, and I just want to review now the 6 again. Ion dipole, focus once again on the lower end of the spectrum where it starts around 40 kilojoules per mole. Hydrogen bonds, 10 kilojoules per mole, the strongest of the covalent bonds. Dipole-dipole, two covalents that have poles side by side, around 5 kilojoules per mole. Ion-induced dipole, 3 kilojoules per mole. Dipole-induced dipole, somewhere around 2 kilojoules per mole. And the weakest are London forces. Basically, when you have two non-polar molecules that come near to each other, Or this could also apply to atoms, how atoms bond to themselves if they're not bound covalently or metallically. I hope this helps you understand intermolecular forces.